This video is going to give a quick user overview of the IC605 print driver for the Konica Minolta. This is just going to be a high-level overview for casual users. We'll start on the General tab. The biggest thing for the General tab is this is a place you can customize so that the options you most commonly use on the print files can be moved up to the front and selected from a single screen without having to go through the other sections. As we move on to the next button down the line, the layout button, the first thing in this section is two-sided. You can tell by looking down the right-hand side, there's illustrations that show what your output is expected to look like. In this case, I'm going to do a letter on 8.5 by 11, and I'm delivering as flat sheets. You can see the corner of the page is turned down, indicating that this page is duplexed. If I turn that off, you can see that that turns back to a simplex document. Under Imposition, the most common option that someone would select would be Booklet. You can tell when this happens that my illustration changes to show that I have taken individual pages, done a signature imposition for those onto 11 by 17, and that I am going to half fold and staple those. When you select Booklet from this imposition space, it will automatically change the settings on the finishing to be multi-half fold and two position. If you don't want that to make a booklet on the machine, you want it to deliver flat sheets so you can take that to an offline device, you can turn that off so that flat sheets can be delivered out to where you can then take those to an offline booklet maker. Back on my layout tab, under imposition, the next most common setting that someone would use would be the two repeat. That is going to take a document and place two letter size pages side by side on your 11 by 17 sheet so that you could print two books on a sheet of paper and cut those in half. That's a common scenario in a print shop that has a cutter. To save on click charges, they'll print it on a larger sheet and cut that in half to get two books out of a sheet. In binding position, you can change the way that the page bind is going to flip, so you can do top to top or left to right. You can also come down and specify paper size, so I could say that I would like to print this on a 12 by 18 sheet. This is now going to center those pages on a 12 by 18 sheet. Moving over to the finishing tab, I can put a staple on the sheet. In this case, I can do a staple or two position. This two position is two staples along the edge of an 8.5 by 11 sheet. It is not a center staple. That is selected down here under the fold and staple option. If I'm putting a staple in my document, I've also got the option to divide output. On divide output, I can tell it how many pages are in a set, and it will apply my finishing options at that interval. This would be helpful if I had a 400-page PDF file and I would like to put four pages into a stapled set. In this case, I could tell this that I wanted four pages in a section. It would do page 1, 2, 3, 4, staple those together, then 5, 6, 7, 8, staple those together, and proceed through that document so that I would end up with 100 sets of four pages stapled together. I've also got an option to do a punch. The machine that I'm connected to here has the GBC G2 punch, so my options are multi-punch and double multi-punch. Depending on the configuration of your machine, you may have no punch options, or you may have two-hole, three-hole, four-hole. It depends on, once again, how your finishing devices are configured. Fold. If you've got a folding device on your machine, in my case I've got a booklet finisher on there, so it gives me an option to multi-trifold, multi-half-fold. Some of the other options that may be available depending on the configuration of your device may be half-fold, tri-fold, Z-fold, and so forth. Output tray. In most cases, you can leave this at default and it will send it to whatever your machine's default exit tray is. You also have the ability to specifically select an exit tray. On the machine that I am configured with now, I have a finisher at the end, so I have a staple main tray exit and a staple sub tray exit. I also have a relay unit that has an exit on it. Once again, depending on your configuration and the options you've got in line, you may have more or less options available for where you want the paper to exit. You've got options towards the bottom here for offset output sheets. If you choose offset output sheets, you can then specify an interval that you would like those sheets offset. So if for example, you were printing 200 pages of something and you wanted to offset every 50 sheets, you could do that. You can also offset output copies, in which case, if you do multiple copies of a book, you could say that I want to offset every 10 sets of a book so that you could package those more easily if you wanted to. On the paper button, we will see at the top, I've got an acquired tray and paper data button. If I click on that button, the driver is going to go ask the machine which paper is configured in that machine. If it successfully connects and communicates with the machine, you'll see that I end up with a green check after the button, and the paper that is currently in my paper trays has been populated back into my paper tray settings. And if any updates had been made to the paper profiles in the paper catalog stored with this machine since the last time I acquired data, that would be updated here as well. From here, I can select I would like to use a tray, so I could say I would like to print from tray number 3. You'll see that it knows that tray number 3 has the 11 by 17 gloss text in it, so it populates that in my paper profile automatically. If I wanted to use a tray 3 but I wanted to use a different paper, I could come in and select a different paper. It would let me do that, but I would then have to go put the proper paper in the machine for that operation. In most cases, the easiest way to utilize the paper trays on this machine is to select by the paper profile, leave the paper tray on auto, and let the machine pick the tray that it's going to pull paper from based on the paper that you've asked for without having to determine which tray that is. On the cover button, I can set up covers around my document. I can specify what tray I want to pull the cover stock from. So if I pick a tray and paper is listed by name in that supply, it will come back and tell me what paper that is. I can tell it that if I want to pull multiple sheets of that paper, so maybe I want to pull 2 sheets on the front of the book from that tray, I can do that. I've also got the option whether to print on that sheet or not. You'll see by default, it does not print on that sheet, and page 1 will be inside of the cover. If I put a check in the print box, it moves page 1 onto the front cover, so I can print my cover from my set onto the job. I've got the same settings that are available on the back cover tray. The next button is page settings. There are a few things I can do here. I can select chapters and put chapter pages in which case what I'm specifying to the driver is that I want these pages to be on the front of duplex sheets. Since page 4 would normally fall on the back of a duplex sheet, the driver will automatically insert a blank page after page 3 so that page 4 can move to the front. When you insert pages in this manner, it does not charge you a click for that page that the driver has inserted. This is an advantage over the situation where you go into that file and insert the blank pages yourself. Since those pages exist in the job, you will pay a click for them. This also allows the driver to do the math to figure out whether it needs to do the insertions. As you might be able to tell, when I put page 4 on the front, that's going to move page 7 to the back of a sheet, so it would determine it needs to now put a blank page in front of page 7 to move page 7 to the front of a sheet. The next option I've got is my large white box down here at the bottom. You'll see the instructions. Please double click here to add page specific settings. When I double click, it gives me several options. I can say under same as body that I would like to have page 5 pull from a different paper. I could specify that I want page 5 to pull from tray number 3. So in that manner, you could have colored paper or a different paper stock that you wanted to use for a separator pull into your job to print in line. If I double click again, you'll see that I've got some options for inserting blank pages. So if I wanted to insert some slip sheets, I could insert some slip sheets either before the first page or after the page that I specify. Once again, inserting these pages using the driver does not incur a click charge. I've also got options here for print one-sided and print two-sided. If you remember, our default was that we were going to print everything two-sided. So our job is going to be set to print two-sided, but I can use this option to come in and say pages 7 and 15 should be printed single-sided. It will then pass those pages through the machine one-sided and once again not charge you a click for the blanks that it puts on the back of those pages. There are two buttons here for tabs. We're not going to cover the tab creation in this video. There's another video that covers creating the tabs. What I am going to say here is that there are basically three methods that you can use to create tabs. One of them is to shift the content of the page a half inch to the side so that text that is along the side of the page will be placed onto a tab. I can convert an existing page into a tab and then add text to go onto the tab for that page, and I can insert pages into the set that do not exist and have those created as tabs. For color mode, there's really only one setting in here that we will discuss, and that is this first line of output color. Auto color is going to inspect the pages as they process. If it finds a black and white page, it will print that in black and white mode. If it finds that the page has color on it, it will print it in color mode. If I click the radio button for grayscale, then the job will automatically convert to grayscale and print in grayscale. In full color, the processing does not try to determine whether there is color on a page. It processes every page as if it was color. In some cases, this can increase the speed of processing and possibly the speed of printing. And it may also leave grayscales as process grays so that they would better match grayscales on the rest of your document. We're going to skip the management tab and go to the quality tab. In my machine, I have the IQ501 installed, so I have the option for auto image adjustment available. I've got the option to choose position or position and gradation so that I can put marks on my sheets and monitor those through the job to feedback correction information into the machine if I needed to do that. On the imaging tab, the only option we're going to discuss at this time is 600 dpi and 1200 dpi. The machine by default will print 1200 dpi. You may in some cases want to set it for 600 dpi. The two major reasons to do this would be large jobs, especially jobs with a lot of graphics on them, may process faster. You may see some loss of resolution in photos and graphics. If the priority is speed over quality, that may be a good choice to make. And the 600 dpi may be something that you set so that the quality more closely resembles another device that is perhaps running part of this job. Forms is another topic that we will discuss in depth in another video. The only thing that I'll mention about forms at this point is to tell you that this allows you to store a form onto the machine as a background image that you can overprint at another time with another document. Image position. By default, the image shift is off. I have the option to shift front and backs evenly. If you look at what happens with my diagram here on the right, as I put in a shift, you can see that I shift both the fronts and the backs the same. And if I select shift front and back separately, then I can put in different values for the front and the back to get those to align the way that I would like them to align. You will notice the other option that I've got here is image position. This option will be available if your paper size is selected to be larger than the size of the print file. For example, if you've got a letter size document and selected to print it on 11 by 17, this lets you choose where on that sheet that image should be placed. So I can shift it to the left or right edge, or I can leave it at the default, which is in the center of the page. Under the marks button, this section allows me to put crop marks on the page, and I can specify some measurements as far as how those are placed in relation to my document. On the stamp button, you'll see that I can place time and date information or page numbering on those. This is not a true base stamp number. This is just page numbering that can be done. On the workflow tab, we are going to instruct the machine what it should do with those printed pages. We'll see that the first thing is print mode, so normal is just going to print the job normally. I've also got an option to proof the job. In this case, if I'm going to run 500 or something and I select proof, it will print one and wait for me to stop and inspect that job and then tell the job to resume. I can also choose wait. Wait is going to send the job and process it at the machine, but it waits for the operator to release it from the control panel of the machine. Output method. Hold is going to hold on the machine, and it would go into the jobs folder under the hold section. If I do print, it will just directly print out of the machine. I've also got the option to print and hold, so I can print it and leave it on hold for a reprint later if I wanted to. Store on hard drive is another option to have it stored on the machine. It just stores in folders under a different section of the jobs tab. I can do secure print. When I do secure print, it allows me to put an ID name and a password on there so that when I got to the job to retrieve this, I would put in whatever my ID that I entered and the password. It would show me the jobs that had been sent over using those credentials, and I could print those when I was there. The authentication button allows you to put the proper information in. If your machine is set for user authentication or account tracking, you've also got the button available to acquire authentication information. It will then ask the machine how it is configured and give you the proper options here to line up with that. On the configure button, we come back to this button and look at the driver options, and this is where I can configure the general panel so that I can change this to have the print options that I use on a regular basis. The other configuration under driver options is customize panel order. When I do customize panel order, I can turn on and off the panels and change their order, so I can arrange these buttons at the top and only leave the buttons that I would like to see.